This Austin attacked very bitterly in a series of lectures he repeated almost annually called Sense and Sensibilia. I think his attack was in some respects a little unscrupulous, but as far as he was concerned, any stick was good enough to beat what he thought was error with.
Yes, I remember Austin was very mocking about this.
And Austin was very mocking for the war, and finally he slew the whole thing in a famous set of lectures and really drove it
through. Before the war, when I used questions like, well, sense datum, what is the sense datum? What is the average lifespan of a sense datum? If you look at the room, how many sense data are there? Can you count them? Do sense data last for, what is the average lifespan of a sense datum? 4 seconds, 2 hours? When a thing turns from blue to light green, are there two sense data or is there one? I remember one particular occasion which, Freddie, I was particularly passionate in his defense of these sense data, and Austin stymied every move and produced these, can't take examples, when they tried to stop his progress in these matters without putting in anything of his own at all, and Freddie became rather impatient and said, you're like a greyhound that doesn't want to run itself and bites the other greyhounds so they can't run either. That was really good. We all laughed a great deal, including Austin, I must say.
I rather disapproved of what was going on. It seemed to me then, and it still seems to me, that purely linguistic philosophy, in the way he practiced it, philosophy restricted to the analysis of good English usage, was something of a blind alley. It didn't seem to me that it really could lead to the solution of any very important philosophical problems. Perhaps I can give an illustration. One of Austin's most famous papers is one called A Plea for Excuses, which is supposed to be an approach towards the old problem of free will. And he approaches it from the point of view that ascriptions of free will are required by our ordinary habits of praise and blame, that we hold people responsible only if they have free will. And so he investigates conditions of responsibility. And he does this by examining the use of a whole set of words which can be ascribed to human actions: doing things on purpose, doing things inadvertently, doing things unintentionally or intentionally. There's a whole group of words of this kind, and he discriminates them with extreme subtlety and acumen. But at the end of it, one feels, at least I feel, that the free will problem has hardly been touched. I mean, the old problem of the conflict, the tension between freedom and causality, doesn't really come up at all. What you get is an extremely fine dissection of certain forms of English usage, which, as regards the main philosophical problem, seem to me to leave us very much where we were. Again, I don't want, I think, to disparage Austin too much. I think he did some very, very remarkable work. For instance, his discovery of what he called performative statements was extremely important. He was one of the first to point out that lots of statements like I promise to do and do so and so aren't descriptions of fact at all, but statements in which one engages oneself, statements that, as it were, take the place of actions, and his whole exploration of this field seemed to be significant. How much the purely linguistic approach depended on Austin's personality, on his authority, is shown by the fact that it didn't survive his death. He died in 1960, just a year after my own return to Oxford, and since then, I think almost nobody has gone in at all heavily for purely linguistic philosophy. Indeed, already in the late 50s, there were signs of a different attitude, of something more enterprising, wider, in the publication of two books, one by Strawson, who is now succeeded Ryle as Professor of Metaphysics here, a book called Individuals, and one by Stuart Hampshire called Thought and Action. Of the two, Strawson was the closer to Austin, had been more influenced by Austin, and his book still contains some trace of linguistic philosophy, but it doesn't go very deep. I mean, mainly, Individuals is a book in the tradition of Kant, an attempt to unearth the fundamental categories of our thinking, and it's a speculative and an imaginative book in a way I think that Austin can't wholly have approved of. It's doing philosophy much more along the lines that I talked of at the beginning, in trying to construct a map of our concepts, trying to analyze the roots of the structure of our thinking. And Hampshire's book was a book of the same kind, but less tightly organized than Strawson's, less logical, depending less on argument, more on a kind of orchestration of ideas. And it interestingly owed very much, I think, to continental philosophy. I think of all contemporary British philosophers, Hampshire is the closest to what's going on abroad, to the movement known as the movement of phenomenology in abroad, which consists in trying, almost in a kind of psychology, trying to give accurate descriptions of the content of our experience.
In the last 12 years, since I came back to Oxford, there's been further change in the climate, but not a spectacular change. The main thing, I think, is that Oxford philosophy has become much less monolithic. There's no longer any one dominant figure, and there's no longer a single dominant approach, partly due to the great emergence of the medical philosophy in the last decade or so. Finally, there's been increasingly a greater concentration on the philosophy of science, and not only on the philosophy of science, but on the connection of philosophy with science, an attempt to make philosophy itself more scientific and for it to take more account of scientific questions. Now, I think this is a very encouraging trend indeed, because I do believe it's really only in conjunction with science that philosophy has a hope for a very flourishing future. This was a connection that existed until the 19th century, when it broke as a result of the Romantic movement, and is now being re-established again to some extent.
Is philosophy, at least as practiced in Oxford today, merely a second-order activity? That is to say, is it anything more than an analysis of the concepts employed in ordinary speech and the presuppositions employed by those in other disciplines who are engaged in direct research of some kind in the physical and social sciences, for example, which philosophers call first order?
But think of the ordinary person using a concept. Now, he doesn't have a clear idea what the structure of that concept is. He just uses it. In one sense, he understands it because he gets it right. He picks out people that are in love and those that aren't, say. But he doesn't see what's involved in that concept. The Oxford philosopher might be able, through analytic techniques, to present him a clear picture of what's involved, what implications his using that concept has. And then he may decide, you know, well, I'm not going to use that concept. Now, there's some Oxford philosophers that didn't. But what I'm concerned is to distinguish the question as to why Oxford philosophy hasn't taken up this kind of question. Whether is there something in this methodology? Is there something in analytic philosophy? Or rather, is it just the sort of persons that practiced it weren't interested in? And my own feeling is that you need a sociological explanation about Oxford's position in British society to see why people have cut off the discussion at a certain point. And there's nothing in analytic philosophy and the methodology of that precludes this other and more interesting kind of question being asked and posed.
It happens to be the case that Moore and Wittgenstein weren't at Oxford, but certainly philosophers here were very much concerned with the things they had to say. And on the one hand, you have Moore saying, well, I mean, our philosophical analyses don't have any bearing on the truth value of the propositions of ordinary life. And on the other hand, you have Wittgenstein coming out with things like philosophy leaves everything the way it was. Uh-huh. And you have Austin giving the impression that what he thinks he's doing is simply kind of dissolving or deflating philosophical issues, sort of showing how really what we always used to think were great issues really are nothing at all.
I don't think it's true to say that Austin was deflating the great philosophical questions. I think he was merely saying that before we can hope to answer them, we've got to answer lots of very intricate questions beforehand.
I think that's true of a great deal, actually, of recent philosophy, that the recent philosophers have practiced the piecemeal approach. Mm. So rather than being interested in the grand questions, they've asked rather small questions.
Yes.
I think the feeling has been that either the grand questions aren't worth asking, or that it's only be asking the small questions that you hope to get answered to the grand questions.
Yes, I certainly think it's a second.
And yet it has been characteristic of philosophy as practiced in Oxford that after a while, whatever the intentions to begin with, do these other questions, the larger questions, just get lost sight of.
That's what's overlooked in the building block model of philosophy. I mean, get the truth here, add it up to the truth here. Mm. But really, we can sweep that aside with one change of attitude on a large question.
There doesn't seem to be a self-consciously Oxford movement today in the way that there was 10 or 20 years ago.
Yes, but there were certain personalities that dominated. Yeah. I mean, one does hear from people, not just from people who went on to be philosophers, from people who went on to be other things. They remember the Austin's Thursday afternoon sessions, Saturday morning sessions, and how professional philosophers used to come and cower at his feet and be afraid to open their mouths. And there doesn't seem to have been anything like that here recently, and of course there was the same phenomenon in Cambridge with Wittgenstein earlier. I doubt very much whether any of us have experienced that sort of thing since we've been here. And that does make a difference.
But someone was suggesting that, I mean, by Oxford philosophy, they meant philosophy in Oxford 10 years ago. I mean, what do people think about Oxford?
The thing about Oxford was, you see, that there were a great many philosophers here always, at least in my time. The sheer number was very large. Philosophy thrives on discussion, on dialogue, on conversation. And if we could convince each other, that's all we wanted. If we could convince each other in our little discussion groups or even in tutorials or wherever it might be, this is enough. Thank you.